I'm extremely old-fashioned person, and what I'm doing is nearly extinct today in the time of specialists for music from 1737 to 39 or something like this. And for me, music is a whole cosmos which really embraces all the activities which have to do with music. And what I'm doing is exactly the same what the composers did in 18th century, in 19th century. Nearly every composer was a very, very first-class instrumentalist. In case of Bach, he was violinist, organist, expert of organ building, really the, and he was conductor of a collegium musicum. He conducted the cantatas. He was composer, and he even taught Latin in the school in Leipzig. And Mozart was, as his father said, quite a remarkable violin player. Mozart himself said, no, it's not true, but he was one of the greatest pianists of the time. And the only exception probably is then Schumann, who had an injury on the finger, and then he gave up his ambition to be a great piano virtuoso. But still, this mentality of the virtuosic piano is very important for the output of Schumann. And I think the very first, only, one says only conductor was Hans von Bülow, but he was, and this was forgotten, also one of the most virtuosic pianists in the time. He even has written some quite interesting compositions. Today you have conductors who did a little bit of percussion, and that was all. And then they write in the telephone book as profession, dirigent or something. And I, from the beginning, I played several instruments. I started very early with recorder with 4 years, and then 6 years piano, and then I wanted to start oboe with 8 years, but in my village it was not possible to have an oboe. They said you have to learn clarinet, so I learned clarinet. But then I switched finally with nine and a half to oboe. But in the same time I started to write a lot of music in a very amateurish way. But this was always together, composition, piano and oboe. For me it was, and I did the whole school, gymnasium, baccalaureate, everything. I was never short of time, I think, even when I did so many things. And this is probably also what reflects a little bit my activity as an instrumentalist. I'm absolutely uninterested in just showing my instrument. I'm oboist. No, I'm only a musician, and the oboe is just a medium to express what I have as musical ideas. It could be any instrument, but as I was singing a lot in a chorus, soprano, and then lost the voice, the oboe was a little bit the replacement of a nice soprano voice. And it's why I didn't get tired of the oboe probably till now. And then I studied composition with pupil of Kodály and pupil of Bartók, Sándor Veres, and I nearly learned everything from him in music. As today, his other pupil, Kurtág, also represents somebody who is deeply involved in the interpretation also of old music. And this was the same case with Veres, and also his teacher, Bartók, was one of the greatest pianists also for classical music of the whole 20th century. And so I, for instance, had my first Schumann shock. I already played these easier pieces, but then when I was 15, I heard a concert with Schumann's third piano trio, one of the most difficult pieces of his, the second violin sonata, and the Geistervariationen. And it's about the most complex and difficult music you can get from Schumann. And I was completely taken over by this music. And since the age of 50, now since 60 years, it becomes worse and worse the longer I live. And then it's quite normal that also the music of Schumann is reflected in my own way of composing. I started very much in the style of Veres, it's Hungarian speaking music, I would say, with great rhythmic energy, but the harmonic side was a sort of neglected in favor of the polyphonic thinking. And then later I came, when I was 21, to Boulez, and this was just the opposite. There was no polyphony, no linear thinking. Everything was vertical. Everything was harmony. And for me it was a great luck that I had those two extremes together, by chance, in fact, because Boulez then taught in Basel, and he taught only 2 years composition of the official in his whole life, and I had those 2 years. and also through Boulez, who was a very good pianist and also fantastic conductor, I had a very easy access to his world, because I was also a practical musician. We had never any theoretical or ideological difficulties together, because we could meet on a common ground. He thought I'm an incurable romantic character, and he left me as I was. He couldn't change me. He changed by the time later, luckily. And now Schumann was, I played also already in competitions or concerts. I played in piano the Fantasy, which is quite a virtuosic piece, and I studied piano with Yvonne Lefebvre in Paris, the teacher of Dino Lipatti also. And there I got the sense of what the piano could be. She never talked about fingering, she only talked about, now this should sound like four horns, this should sound like a cello, this should sound like a piccolo, this should sound, now your pedal should be like a beautiful orchestration of Debussy with resonances. And she never talked about the black and white of this machinery here. That's a machine, you know, when you don't bring it to life. And it's why I never was interested in the abstract piano, exactly the same as Schumann. He never, for him, the piano was the direct channel to go from the inside to the outside. He spoke through the piano, and his first pieces are only piano pieces which really are so revolutionary in the idea of form, of treatment, also technical treatment. It was the time of big virtuosos, Thalberg, Dreischock, all those people who have written big treatises for piano playing, only technical, or Hertz, etc. And it's what Schumann learned with Wieck, who is the father of Clara Schumann. But he never was influenced by this way of looking at the piano. And when the poor little Clara came into contact with Schumann, he told her that she spends her life with only bad music and that life is too short and she should look at some Bach preludes and fugues and learn proper music really on the piano. And then Clara, thanks to this, she was the most interesting pianist of her time. And I have written piano music in the time of Veres, but when half a year before I went to Boulez, I have written this Elis 3 Nocturnes, 3 Nachtstücke, very Schumannian title for piano, and you will hear them tonight. And this is a music which is very far from an abstract instrument. It's music from the beginning I thought it for orchestra, and I also orchestrated it later, and Boulez premiered the orchestra version. It's a piano full of very, very special colors, of echoes, of resonances, and probably also very much influenced by the music of Debussy, which is, next to Schumann, one of my top favorite composers. And I never was influenced by the piano of Boulez. The second sonata, very harsh, or in the structure one, very harsh, very abstract way of treating the instrument. Only the structure is important, not the color. And I think I never could go into this way of thinking music. Later I've written nothing for piano alone. It was my instrument. And I played, usually I accompanied only singers or so when they played my things, but I used it only as accompaniment instrument for the Lieder ohne Worte, to books of violin pieces, but also in a very special way, using many techniques I learned from my wife, the harpist, with harmonics treatment on the piano, which I like so much. And I didn't dare writing for the piano, because I thought it was so, there is such a big concurrence when you write for piano. You have always Beethoven behind your shoulder who looks at your paper, or Schumann or Debussy, whatever, even or Liszt. And I thought the piano doesn't need me. And then, as we had a an ensemble with winds and piano with Andras Schiff and Aurel Nicole, Edward Brunner, Klaus Thunemann, Radovan Vladkovic. We played a lot of Schumann solo pieces for our instrument, or then the quintet by Beethoven, quintet by Mozart, etc. But we needed something else to oppose, and then I started to write a very strange piece for piano and four winds, a quintet, which is not really a quintet, but it's more a duo. It's a duo for piano and a group of four winds, which are absolutely not homogeneous in sound. But the idea is first the winds, they dominate and they just trigger or create resonances in the piano. The piano is like a sleeping body, and with a pedal down, suddenly some notes resound in the thing. Then, bit by bit, the pianist touches the strings, he makes little more noisy sounds, and the winds get softer and softer and always more noise-like sounds, and the piano gets always more piano, 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 till the outburst of a really very virtuosic piano writing, which comes much more from Bartok's piano writing than from Debussy's in this piece, because it's written for Andras Schiff, who is Hungarian. And this was my way of treating a piano. It's nearly a concerto for piano, and the second duo part, which is a group of winds. And only then, much later, in the last days of last century, I finished this big piece on 31st of December in 1999. Without willing, it was just by accident, but I tried to rush a little bit to finish still in the old century. And it's also part of the old century very much, this music. And I thought to write a piece which again doesn't appeal to the say more colorful side of piano playing, which I like so much, but more to the way Andras Schiff plays piano. He practically doesn't perform Ravel or Debussy or Messiaen, and he hates deeply Liszt, but he's a great Bach player. He's a fantastic architect of the biggest fugues of Bach, and a great Schumannian also, Schumann player. And then I started to try to develop a sort of autoportrait of this musician. First, already very, very often when I compose, I use those soggetti cavati, which are the letters are changed into notes. And you could once A-D. And this probably good pianists will just remember, what is it? It's Andras. But when you hear this, you remember two very famous pieces for piano. And it's Nuage Gris by Liszt and the beginning of the Alban Berg Sonata. Yeah, okay. But anyway, I used everything. I used the rhythms of his birthday as form of the Passacaglia, and at the end with 21, 12, 53. And this is the formula of this enormous passacaglia, for instance. And then I used not only his name, but also his likes and dislikes. For instance, the first prelude, it's like if a Couperin or a Rameau piece starts and the harpsichord player just warms up in sort of improvisation with big arpeggiando things, and this is a sort of this. The black written notes, probably we can now, yeah, the black written notes are the, if you want, the Couperin or Rameau. Can you play this without the resonance? Etc. Yeah. And now you have here in brackets innere Stimme, and pianists would know this title also from Schumann. It's in Opus 12 in the second piece, the middle voice, which is written on a special stave, is called innere Stimme. It's a middle voice in a polyphonic pattern which doesn't appear really, which is completely covered by the voices around. And I thought this innere Stimme is much more. It's something you hear inside you. It could be probably music which is 400 years old, purely tonal, only triads, and they are not played actually, but they appear as resonance of the very dramatic lower part, the black notes. You see, can you once just play the white things? What composer uses this every time? We call it Terzverwandtschaft, parenthesis of the third. We have C major and then the third of A flat major is the same note. It's mediante, yeah, and Schubert does it all the time. Yeah. And then on. Of tritonos, a B major together with F major. Then play again a B major and F major. And now this is third. It's like a Neapolitan thing inverted to E major. Now again. The same tritonos, parenthesis, to B flat. Now again the third parenthesis, Terzverwandtschaft, to D major. And now again as a Neapolitan. Yeah, okay. And so on. And this is, you could think it's some backstage chorus singing this part, and it's a completely different music sort, music as from inside your body, and you play outside a very dramatic, completely dissonant music, but which triggers the beautiful music. All the notes give, when you do with the keys, you press them down, mute, yeah, that you don't hear it, mute touch, and then they sound in the resonance of the low notes. Yeah, you could play probably not the whole piece, but play a little bit. And they also, the piece gets more and more rhythmical structure, and those rhythms will be very important later. But it's a really prelude, a piece which is played before the piece starts. And just the end, the last line, you see he plays with the arm, the whole cluster, and the E flat specially, and then he takes off very slowly the pedal, and now he does a negative arpeggio. He takes one key after the other away, and this is exactly from Papillon, the effect of Schumann also, what he used also. It's like a negative of an arpeggio, you take off notes instead to add, and it ends on the E flat, and this is Schumann's signature, yeah. When he writes about him, music, his own music, it's always in E flat minor, mostly, like the Manfred Ouverture, like the Ceremony, the fourth movement in the Third Symphony, like Geistervariationen, like his quintet. Yeah, it's the SCH is really. Can you play SCH? Yeah, and this comes everywhere in Schumann. Or then the F, A, E. Frei, aber einsam. And this comes practically in all A minor pieces, many times you will hear it. There is nothing else in the Schumann romance that this cell, which is everything is built like in a Weben cantata on one monad, really, the whole music is. And this makes Schumann so modern, he did exactly what Bach did, yeah, 100 years before, and what Liszt did very much later, and what Weben or Alban Berg did also that. Okay. And now I had the idea of making an homage to András Schiff and naturally to write the fugue. And I thought I write a sort of fugue, like the five-part fugues in C sharp minor in the first Old Temperierte Klavier book. And you play the theme. Result, it's at least a seven-part fugue, because the range of the voices is enormous, goes to the highest, to the deeps, and they trigger other voices which you think to recognize, but you lose them again, and it's probably more a fugue in the sense of Max Reger. has written in tonal style, extremely complex music, very often very, very much more complex than Schoenberg. And this is more or Busoni, the view of Busoni, Busoni's Bach. He thought, for instance, this five-part fugue is like, in his edition he made big prefaces, he has written this fugue is like a Gothic cathedral, and you have to fill the whole space with those five voices. And I tried a little bit this with only three voices. And what's not like in old music, there is no common time organization. Very often you have a diminution or augmentations of the theme, but 1 to 3 or 1 to 5, not in even metrums. And it's why the whole piece gives a little bit impression of drowning or dizziness, I think. It's and we could probably once play only the theme. Andrasch. Classically, in D instead of A, the inversion. No, play the second line. And now you have it the third time in the real thing, but transposed not in a relation of dominant tonica, but in a relation only a second below the first entry, and in G. Now again you have the dominant relation, the inversion. Subject like in bar 7. From the G. And then the bass in A underneath, just the bass. In the bass, it's an augmentation, but every note has 5 sixteenths instead of 4 sixteenths, and so on. It gets much more complicated, but probably play once the beginning. In the beginning I have a few notes added as a sort of resonance, like harmonic resonance, only in the first two bars, like like a harpsichord player who adds a little ornament to his bare one voice theme. Yeah. Before it, you had a part largamente piena sonorità, which refers probably also to the last entry of the fugue theme in Bach's five-part fugue with a low C sharp, B sharp, etc. And here it's the first time that the fugue has more than three parts, but only sort of like trombones who double some notes. And then it ends in an outburst, like a sort of firework, and just breaks down. And then those gestures are of the explosion are repeated, and every time there is like an innere Stimme in the prelude, a resonance, a mute resonance. But those resonances are now from our century. They are really dissonant and in very close, very chromatic chords. And at the end, you have also all the 12 notes, F sharp to G, and he takes off note per note till only the C is remaining. Yeah, you have can you play this once? Just play the cluster loud and take it off. And this is the beginning of the next piece. Yeah. And now András Schiff. Yeah, his name is Ship, and Barcarola is a Schiffer lead. And in same time, it's a very famous piece by Chopin, which András loves very much. But very similar also is one of the greatest pieces of Liszt, Lugubre Gondola. We have a funeral, gondola funebre, if you want. And it's a little bit ambiguous between the two words. It's much more Liszt, which is absolutely not András' favorite. But the metronome was exactly the age of András when I have written it, 43. And now, this is a very famous fragment poem of Hölderlin, uns wiegen lassen wie auf schwankem Kahne der See. Object and subject are changed. You don't know if the sea is shaking or if the boat is shaking. Because it's what you feel when you are in a boat. The water comes up and down, but it's dancing. From Mnemo Sune, by me. And then later, it's even a very, very dramatic section in the middle. It's written in brackets, Hommage à Rimbaud et son bateau ivre, yeah, the drunken ship, this most famous poem of Quand je passais des fleuves impassibles, les peaux rouges me prenaient pour cible. I think first we have this rocking rhythm, ternaire rhythm, and then bit of bit it goes in a completely chaotic world and nearly to the collapse, probably much more dramatic than in the fugue, because it's not such a dense polyphonic writing, it's more a homophone writing. And then again, it ends with the with the retrograde movement of the first theme at the end, and ends with the rocking rhythm of the barcarolle. So you have this barcarolle, a short genre piece, and then also Chardash Obstine, a little genre piece, and it's framed by this enormous fugue and even much more enormous megalomanic bassacaglia monoritmica, Giacomo monoritmica. And now in between we have again the idea of Schumann's Carnival. He writes Sphinx twice. You have the name of Schumann, the first we do it with E flat A C H. And this is the name of Asch. It's a village where his first fiancée, Ernestine von Fricken, was born. But it's also the only musical letters in Schumann's name, Asch, and it's Ashes. You will hear about this later in the cello piece. And those Sphinx are very long notes, like in medieval music, but they are not played during the performance. They could be just inside your soul. They are here. And the whole piece is written on the lettres dansantes, those letters. And I thought now I write two sphinxes for sh, but it's Schumann or Schiff, you don't know exactly. But it's music which plays only in the inside of the piano, within the body of the instrument. You could think it's a sort of encephalogram, a graphic of the activation of the brain of the composer or the musician. And those use practically non-normal notes, except the few notes of the name of the dedicatee. It's not really a piece which shows effects of a nice colors of the piano, but it's more a masked music. You could imagine normal sounds behind those noises you hear now, or other instruments also behind you. You hear probably four tom-toms at the beginning, and then you hear marimbas, you hear a harp harmonic, you hear a rim shot of a drum or something, and there also a lot of very airy glissandos on along the strings, the wire of the strings, etc. The first Sphinx, it's the first intermezzo. Those pieces have not to be played when you don't like. You can do a performance without those inside pieces, which it's like a little intermezzo. Okay, now at the end, it's a quotation of one of my old piano pieces of Elis, Three Nocturnes, the end of the second piece. When you do a glissando on the strings with a finger, you have a strong vibration, and after a while, when you put very slowly the pedal on the string, it gives like a ghost would play in the piano without touching the piano. It makes a crescendo, because the same energy of the long string is now reduced to a short distance of the string, and it's why it gets again louder. It takes the energy of the, you know, of the division of the string and makes this. And this is also the end of Elis number two. Yeah. Now, Liszt has written a lot of short pieces in his very latest period, and he was very much influenced by the German-Hungarian poet Nikolaus Lenau, who in his Faust had also the Mephisto playing those Hungarian tunes which Lenau himself played on the guitar or on the violin. And for Liszt, this was a very, very important, also national task to honor a country who was occupied by the Austrian monarchy. And really the not the nationalism in the bad sense, but the national feeling really woke up, and this directly led to Bartok and Kodály's collection of the folk music. And a csárdás is a dance who has always inverted rhythms. For instance, ya ta da da ta ta da da ti ta da da ta da da ti ta da da ta da da ta da da ta da. And I used this. It's also a title by Liszt, csárdás obszcéné, but it does. I have no. No quotations of Liszt, but as Gondola Lugubre is present in Barcarolle, this csárdás is present in this piece. When you look at the bass, could you play very slowly? In the seven notes you have andra shift. E flat S C H F gives sh f, yeah, and the first A D us what we had before. Now this this figure of seven notes comes 49 times, seven multiplied by seven. And then you have all the permutations possible of those seven notes. And it gives like a sort of groovy ostinato bass. Play it once, just the left hand. It's never the same following of the notes. Now, out of the seven notes, I still have five notes left, and this forms the upper part. Play it very, very, very slowly. It's always the same five notes in different order, and in a 2-4 rhythm against the 7-2-4 rhythm of the bass, and you have the rhythm of the chata yare ta ti ta yara da 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 ti da da yara ta da da ti da da ti da 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 da. And this is again a sort of genre piece, a very short piece, to lighten up a little bit the very heavy mood of the whole Partita. And Minacissimo, you have all the notes of the csárdás, those five notes, which are like in a whirlwind, they come together with all the 12 notes in five beats. And it ends in a typical Hungarian recitation, yara. And now comes even a stranger piece in the piano. It's only based on glissandos on the string with a flat hand, and in same time you press down the keys of a sort of chorus like in the prelude, always on triads, and through those airy noises of the glissandos you hear those triads again. It's a technique which was used first by Henry Cowell in Banji, a very famous piano piece, I think in the before the 20s, in 18 or 19. In this total harmony, you hear again the notes played by the thumb on the string with A, S, A, us. It's also Andras. Good. And now comes this Chacona monorhythmica. For instance, Alban Berg has written in Lulu a very famous monorhythmica, and also in the violin concerto. The whole rhythmic section of the third movement is based on the chi cha ri cha chi cha cha da cha da da. It's like an extra systole of a heart disease. And monorhythmica is also in the Wozzeck, for instance. When you, after the murder of Marie, you have a B natural repeated, and the entries are exactly in the Hauptrhythmus, in this A, da, 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 da. And this comes back in the dance scene, in the tavern. The pianist plays play, play, pla, pla, play, ta da. This is exactly the same rhythm. And it comes in the big adagio, Mahler and adagio in Wozzeck. And I now, slightly crazy idea, I used 21st, 2, 1, 12th, 21st of December, 2, 1, 1, 2, 1, 9, 5, 3. Play once the upper voice just on the name of Andraschiff in the second bar. Etc. This comes now 21 bars come with the same rhythm, the 20. And then we have 53 bars in the big middle section development, and at the end we have 12 bars which show a completely different sound of the piano treatment. It's more a Debussy-like piano with widespread and very colorful writing, a sort of short coda. And now it's probably by accident, but when you listen to this theme, it has completely Hungarian declamation. Ja, la di di, la di di, jam pa pa pi, ta ta di di. ti-ta-ta-ta-ta. And when you heard this rhythm in the Partita shops, you know, all the time, yeah, it's already there. And now I tried also to have this monorhythmica, it's a term which Berg himself invented, but that there is never the same music with the same, even with the same notes. And it's then in the second part after page, after a bar 22, page 34, we have now suddenly very big phrases without commas at every bar line, and it gives big, big melodic arches, and it speeds up denser and denser and denser, and louder, till we have in bar 74, then a sort of sudden stop and just the resonance in the pedal of the notes, and then this più calmo, meno mosso, coda. Can you play in this coda only the upper voice, 160, 76? Now you will discover the same theme as you heard before, but in different registers. But now the duration of the notes are permutated. It never repeats exactly the same rhythm. It's a monorhythmica in relation of the whole bar, but not every note. I don't know if you want to go through the whole piece. It needs a lot of energy. Yeah. Yeah, probably. Or I interrupt after 21 bar and then we
just
go on.
Yeah.
First, you have always phrases of single bars, and we play it sort of a tempo and then poco ritardando. A tempo, poco ritardando. It's never an abstract neoclassical straight rhythm as in Stravinsky, but a very, very romantic, very flexible rhythm. And now you have again this resonance as before after this check, and after this resonance comes now the coda, only 12 bars, più calmo and with a lot of also high frequencies which are very seldom in the previous. Play probably the last, only the last bar before. For me, it was very interesting to write a piece for piano, which isn't this, which isn't characterized by the physical side of the fingers. No digital music. You have so many piano pieces which are completely digital music, and I tried just to write very polyphonic music and which is written for 10 fingers, but it sounds not at all out just of the finger, nor normal finger movements, and a lot of modern music you hear is very digital and comes out of purely physical physical motions of the fingers. And I think for me a piano or a great pianist is interesting when I forget about the piano in 30 seconds. I just listen to the music and I don't listen to his flashy arpeggios and flashy trill cascades, but just listen to the music. Probably I never would do it, but it's possible one could orchestrate this Giacona very easily for very for big orchestra, but with probably the instruments all around in the hall in space, distributed in space. And even the prelude could be for orchestras of four harps, two pianos, four marimbas and two cymbaloms or something, and the chorus which sings very far away, like the Sirene of Debussy or something like that. And I'm very happy that Jan plays this music with such a passionate involvement. And, it's really not an easy piece. You have some questions. As I, after this, I went on writing for piano, and now it's just going to be printed. I have 12 piano pieces, but mostly short, published. Also written for birthdays, for in memoriam, for all sorts of occasions. But probably, and I'm just writing for Lucerne Festival piano, sort of piano concerto. See that very late in my life I come back to my own instrument. So very much more.
We can have some break maybe before going to the... If there are no questions, we can...
Yeah, but when you want to ask, there are many strange questions.
You gave us a wonderful insight in your feeling for resonance, and you showed at the beginning, the prelude, for example, the resonance with the chords, which had kind of a quiet progression, and you showed us it based on the...
It's all in triads,
But what about your verticality and all the more difficult parts to listen to? You know, I always see these sevenths and the tritones and the fourth. But is there an idea about the connection from the vertical side to the vertical side?
You mean in the prelude or?
No, for example, this last piece. Or is it purely polyphonic, the horizontal?
No, I think very much harmonic. But naturally, the harmony is also a little bit decided by the structure of the letters of harmony. Of the nuage gris thing, as it is in Berg Sonata or whatever pieces which are based on certain intros. I can't think in series of, for me it's completely unnatural. And everything I write is harmonically designed, but here you have such a complex structure that you probably forget about the basic functional harmony, which is also present. But for me, I very much, very often miss a harmonic feeling in many modern pieces, especially in the neo-romantic composers who use a worn-out harmony, and just very often for me it makes absolutely no sense harmonically what they write. It's just nice listening or easy listening. I think when you take some of Unstern, Nuage Gris, Lugubre Gondola, it's also very concentrated harmony with it. Also this, when you have it, Yeah, this is probably a little bit hard with the fourth and the tritonals. It's quite a glassy sound. When you use more thirds, you get a much more mellow sense of harmony. But when you multiply those chords, those elements of three notes, you can multiply every note by the three notes, and just transpose it on the different, then you can get a very different harmony out also of this material. I used a lot. I thought in ideal that in the fugue, three instruments of a range of four octaves could play this piece, yeah. But with very different colors, three very different instruments. Und Martenow would be the ideal instrument for this big range, but it's practically not possible to use it polyphonically because you have so loud differential sounds. That it's like a buzz in your ear. I tried this out in Offrande Musicale sur le Nom de Bach by Köchlin. We recorded it, and there is one optional bizinium for two Ond Martenow, but finally we played it Ond Martenow on the organ because the polyphony was unbearable. And also the connection with poetry, with literature is extremely important for me. It's everything I do, it has always two bases. Even when I write a purely instrumental piece, there is a lot of language behind. For me, music is also a meta language, language after the language. Did you play Donde Serene? A composer can treat just one single aspect of an instrument, for instance, the low register with chords, or he can. He can write like Olivier Messiaen, really very bright sounds with the bird songs and quite glassy and hard and tank music. It sounds like with xylophone. Or then you have some pieces by Kurtak which are so fantastic in sound of the piano, it's completely transcended the piano. You don't think of a piano anymore. And Kurtak is a little bit same case as Schumann, that he speaks through his instrument, the piano. He also sketches all the music first, sort of piano short score, and then he orchestrated in a very old-fashioned way, for me it's very different. But Veresh was also the same as teacher. Yeah. The piano is also a very dangerous instrument for a composer, and it's why I never write on a piano. My music always at the table, because you fall into traps of your finger go decide where to go and not to. It's probably also it's why it's so far off the normal piano technique.